Garifuna American Heritage Foundation United proudly presents the Clifford J. Palacio Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online. It's every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, through www.lmbroots.com in the Bronx, New York, and www.radiocentroamerica.com in Los Angeles. Classes are free and for the entire family. Download the homework or handout from Facebook's Garifuna Language and Culture Academy page or from www.garifunaheritagefoundation.org. All radio programs will be recorded and archived on YouTube's GAHFU channel for on-demand listening. This project is made possible in part by a grant from the Alliance for California Traditional Arts in partnership with the Walter and Elise Haas Fund and the William and Flora Hewitt and the James Irvine Foundation.
Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for tuning in tonight. This is the Clifford J. Palacio Garifuna Language and Culture Academy, and we have reached a milestone. This is week number 8, lecture number 8 of the first session with Dr. Aranda. This is the first of its kind. It's an experiment called the Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online, and we have one of the best in the Garifuna history. That is the scholar from Belize, Dr. Theodore Aranda, who is here tonight for lecture number 8. So let's welcome tonight Dr. Theodore Aranda. Buto kunyo surusia, ida binya kunyo to.
Buto kunyo rani, magadi ugati ya, yagi ibu mo magadi ugati.
So happy. Good na tina narihin ibu. Not to see you, but to hear you again. Thank you so much.
Okay, rani, okay.
Seremen.
Dami baransi begin.
We're ready, surusia.
Okay.
Gumese.
All right. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is the final lecture on our topic of the history of the Garifuna people. And in spite of the fact that there are very many other aspects of Garifunaness that we could have gone into, we had to select and choose the things that is of major importance to us. And some of the things that sometimes have created some serious problems among us in terms of who we are, where we came from, and how we got here. We have gotten into that, so tonight I'm going to finish the piece of the lecture where we were attacked. As a matter of fact, this past Monday or Tuesday, I picked up two newspapers here in Belize. Amandala was one, Guardian was the other one. And in that newspaper were two articles. And the article was a quotation or a relation of a meeting by a specific religious pastor, and what he was saying there in that interview was that there was a woman, and I think Randy asked that question some time ago, but I didn't take it very, very seriously at that time until I read that article last Monday or Tuesday, where this pastor was saying that there was a woman, and this woman was a buoy, as he called her. And he said that that buoy was a very, very good buoy. However, in one of the degree ceremonies that she attended, she was supposed to have gone through something which this man, because they saw it, so to speak, was flabbergasted by it, and he was really convinced that it was witchcraft. And this woman also, this buoy, after she did that or performed that or that thing happened to her, she stated that this was a devil's workshop. Now, let's go back to what we have said before, and I will just go through it. I'm not going to spend too much time on it, because what I said was, all religious groups and the churches do services to the one and only God, whatever name you give that God. That there were petitions done by people, healings done by God, atonement to the Almighty God for his great gifts, thanksgiving. And with this thanksgiving, I'm just going to mention a few of the things that we ourselves do in Belize. Number one, thanksgiving is religious based. Thanksgiving, that is giving thanks to God, etc. And it is religious based. In other words, it's based on some belief or thankfulness to God for doing the things or for the gifts or for the yields and the fruits and everything else that we benefit from. Our own labor, all right? But giving thanks to God. I mentioned the U.S. Thanksgiving holiday, which is a big holiday in the U.S., and the whole country celebrates that day in Thanksgiving. That's a religious-based holiday. The second thing here in Belize, the other thing here in Belize is, we just got out of the Easter vacation. Easter vacation is about 2 weeks of holiday for the schools. We close our schools for about two weeks. I think that's the one for Easter. 2 weeks vacation. And that's a religious-based vacation. Whatever you believe about it, whatever whether you accept it or not, it is a celebration of the resurrection of Jesus. And in Christmas, there are 3 weeks of Christmas where schools are closed, and we celebrate what we call Christmas, that is the birth of Jesus. Those are all religious groups. Those are all religious holidays. They're all religious-based holidays. And we don't find anyone attacking those holidays or the religiousness that's associated or attached to them. We don't. We just accept it as a tradition. As a matter of fact, too many of us don't even understand that Easter vacation is a vacation given because of the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. Nobody questions that. Nobody argues with it. Nobody says it's witchcraft. Number two, the Christmas vacation, the same birth of Jesus. And there are a lot of stories and a lot of activities that we have around that nobody accuses anybody of being involved in witchcraft. Now, this individual that attacked Garifunas, this individual who used this bouye witnessed what we call levitation. Levitation is the elevation, somebody rises against gravity, so to speak, and you can see that person floating in the air. It's a strange phenomenon. We don't argue about that. It's a strange phenomenon. However, the incident occurred in a degree, and because it occurred in a degree, this man blames the girl, not the woman who did the levitation. Magicians practice levitations. We have seen levitations here and there over and over and over again. Levitation simply means that a person is elevated and floats in the air. There's nothing very, very strange about it, other than the fact that it's not very common to see a person or things float in the air. How it happens is, may not be something that we can easily understand, but it's definitely not witchcraft. Levitation is not witchcraft. Magicians do it over and over again. Now, let's go on to a few other things that we can call strange and odd, or unnatural, if you want to use the word, whereby the most extraordinary thing happens. The Bible is full of miracles and unnatural accounts. The Bible, which these preachers, which these religious people take to be the base of their faith, to be the thing upon which, I mean, to which they go whenever they have any spiritual question. But I have never ever heard any of them say that the Bible is witchcraft. Bible, as I said, is full of miracles and unnatural accounts. Levitation is just one of them. Those of us who have read the story of Moses and the burning bush, when God was supposed to have appeared to Moses to give him the Ten Commandments, in that thing we were able to see, or we were shown, a bush that was burning but without being consumed. In other words, you saw fire in the bush, but there was, the fire didn't burn the bush. And that's another odd, occurrence. But I have never ever heard anybody say that Jesus or God, not Jesus, sorry, that I have never ever heard anybody, and nobody accuses God of practicing witchcraft. Neither have I heard anybody, accusing Moses of practicing witchcraft. And neither have I heard anybody say that the burning bush that Moses witnessed was witchcraft. But it is the Bible that tells us that. And after God, after the burning of the bush, or the whole thing was kind of over, Moses asked Jesus, how am I to tell my people that? They won't believe me. What sign can you give me to show them? And according to the story, I'm not saying I believe it or not believe it, I'm not going to go into that. But the point is that God told Moses at that time, on that very occasion, Moses, there is a rod right by you. Rod is a piece of stick. Right by you, pick up that rod. That's going to be your rod to show them the might and the power of God. And Moses asked Jesus, asked God, how can I tell them that and they'll just laugh at me? God told Moses, according to the story, according to the Bible, throw that stick onto the ground. And when Moses threw the stick onto the ground, the stick turned into a snake, into a viper. That's a pretty odd occurrence. But I've never heard any religious person attack the practice or the mission of Moses for being witchcraft, which they did to the degree. That incident with the stick turning into stone, into snake, happened when God was showing his power to Moses. They did not condemn God of his powers. The people, the religious people who were speaking about this, do not. But yet, that's an incident in a bigger picture. The bigger picture is that God is demonstrating his powers to Moses to be able to take to his people. Gill is exactly the same another incident in which our ancestors are seeking and asking for something. But the point here is this. If they had accused Moses of witchcraft, if they had accused God of witchcraft, then they may be legitimately right to accuse that lady, the witch, the Buye of witchcraft. But that's not what they did. They condemned the whole to be witchcraft. That's another one. But we also see when Moses took that stick and went to the Pharaoh, and he dropped that stick on the ground, and the stick turned into a snake, the Pharaoh and his magicians only laughed at Moses, because they too picked up the stick, dropped it to the ground, and it turned into a snake. Whether or not Moses' snakes ate up the other snakes is not the issue. The point is that the magicians did the same thing. Are you saying that Jesus or that God is practicing witchcraft, or Moses is practicing witchcraft, or that the counselors to the Pharaoh were practicing witchcraft? No. I've never heard that said, and neither should you, neither should anybody believe that that's witchcraft. But it is in the Bible, and I have never heard anybody attacking the Bible to be an act or practice of witchcraft. But yet they feel comfortable attacking a big ceremony like the Bible to be witchcraft. The other one that I think I should mention is what we call exorcism. Exorcism is the extraction of evil spirits out of a possessed person. That's common in the Bible. Jesus himself, according to the Bible, extracted evil spirits out of the pigs and chased those devils into the sea or into the waters. Was Jesus practicing witchcraft when he exorcised the evil spirits out of the pigs? As a matter of fact, that's why many Jews won't eat pig, because they say it's unclean meat. Jesus, not only once, not twice, drew demons and the evil spirits out of those that were possessed. And that's much, much bigger, that much, much greater than levitation. Levitation is a person or a thing or a magical thing in which something is elevated from the ground by itself without any other support or any other means of raising it. The last one I'll use is the raising of the dead. That one tops them all. And we saw, or we read in the Bible, how Jesus rose Lazarus from the dead. As a matter of fact, before Lazarus died, his sisters went to Jesus and asked him to come and save their brother because he was dying. Jesus didn't come right away. Lazarus died and was buried for about 4 days, according to the Bible. This is not my story. I'm not the one saying it. It's in the Bible. And Moses was dead for 4 days till Jesus went to the tomb and raised Lazarus from the dead after being dead for 4 days. I have never ever heard anybody say that that's witchcraft. And that's a much, much more fantastic event than levitation. It's a much, much more fantastic event than somebody believing that he's a Buye and is not. Exorcism is a much bigger issue. The thing that that Buye was supposed to have been doing or somebody else is doing was extracting spirits out of the person, and this man not understanding it, not seeing it, not knowing it, immediately runs around saying that this woman was practicing witchcraft in a the worst part of it is this: he did not say that that woman was practicing witchcraft. What he said was that the girl was witchcraft. So would exorcism be? Is that witchcraft? Raising Lazarus from the dead? Is that witchcraft? The stick turning into snake by Moses? Is that witchcraft? Are the stories in the Bible witchcraft? Those are things that if we only knew the origin of our churches and the origin of the services in the churches, and we were able to understand that that's the same powers and that's the same origin in the good, because I have said it again and again and again, and I'm repeating it now, that the good is the origin of the services in the church of today. This happened way, way back from the beginning of the universe, and that is African. That's not, Bible is, as a matter of fact, extracts much of its teachings from the 42 commandments, 42 negative confessions, much of it, and various other factors. The point I'm making is this: if we only knew what the good was, we wouldn't shoot a lot of nonsense that we shoot about it. And those same people, as a matter of fact, I heard one some time ago saying that she doesn't want to bother with the good because that's witchcraft, and she was going to go to a church. And I asked her the question: did you know that the church comes from the Bible? I mean, it originates with the good and the very from the Buyeba. She just looked at me and couldn't answer the question and walked away. And I was happy about that too, because I didn't want to get involved with people of that service. So there are very many things that if only we knew what they are, we would not be very willing and quick to condemn the things that we don't understand. And that is another thing that the Europeans did when they started to move away from the teachings of the Egyptians. Egyptians are Africans. What they did was they changed the names of the gods of the Egyptians and they put in their own name. Let me give an example, a very simple example. There are very many times a person is, we don't even know the proper name of a person because we know him by a nickname. Let's say, for instance, the person might have been John when he was born, but for some reason people started calling him JJ or something like that, so that you know the person to be JJ, but you don't know him to be John. So that when you speak about only JJJJ, that's the only thing you can refer to. But when somebody else who knew John to be JJ come back and tell you, this guy's nice name is not JJ, his name is John, you argue like, for me, that's what I know him to be, that's what the name he had in school, etc., etc., and it goes down the line like that. It's a very common thing. And that was exactly what the Romans, the Greeks, the English, the Spaniards, the French, the Portuguese did to African names. They removed the African names and put in their own names. Constantine the Great, so to speak, did just that. And there are very many things within the church, within the Bible, within the history of mankind that should and needs to be explained. But yet, because nobody mentions Africa, nobody mentions the great things that other people have done and the church or the Europeans borrow from those people. Nobody mentions that at all. So, let me end the statement with this. That it's unfortunate that the Gill, which is the origin and the beginning of present churches and their services, are not recognized to be that. We cannot connect what the African churches contributed and did to the development of mankind. Now, let's go to a review of some of the things that we had said, and we will explain a little more of that. Remember that we started out with who the Garinagu are. And what I said was, the Garifuna are an African people. They are Africans, not Arawaks or Caribs mixed with African slaves. No. Garinagu are African people who migrated from the place of origin, from where humankind developed. And we call that Olduvai Gorge, or valley, if you want to use the word that. I mean, if you want to use that word. And they traveled or migrated or moved across the continent of Africa from the east right across the continent of Africa till they arrived at Atlantic Ocean. When they arrived at the Atlantic Ocean, they didn't stop there. They were able to cross the Atlantic Ocean. That is our ancestors, the Garifuna people. They were the first to cross the Atlantic Ocean to trade with the natives of the Americas. And when I say Americas, I mean the New World, from South to North America and Central America included, and the Caribbean. And they traded in gold and other merchandise. That's a contribution of the Garifuna people. And that's a contribution of Africans. So that I've heard this before. I've heard people say that, or ask the question, so to speak, what has Africa contributed to the development of mankind? Let's take a brief look at the answer to that story, I mean, to that question. Today, you cannot imagine the volume of trade and commerce that goes from the Americas to Europe and Africa across the Atlantic Ocean. You cannot imagine it. Because it's a very, very busy trade and commerce route. But that was begun by the Garifuna people when they crossed from Africa into the Americas. They were the first to do it. I won't use the word discover, because you don't discover the Atlantic Ocean. They don't discover, neither do they begin, or neither do they create the Atlantic Ocean. They just crossed it. And the business of today, shipment, undersea travels like submarines, etc. Planes fly over the Atlantic, so that the Atlantic Ocean, that gap of water between the old world, that is Africa and especially Europe, and the Americas, is an extremely important and busy piece of trade and commerce route that we cannot imagine the volume of traffic that goes with it, or that goes through it, and neither could we imagine closing it down, because it couldn't be closed down. It would create havoc in the entire world. That was begun by our ancestors. So, and our ancestors used it at that time to trade in gold and other merchandise. And those, and that is how we got our name, Garifuna. The word Garifuna means those who traffic in gold. And those who trafficked in gold were our ancestors, a Mandinga people, an African people. And we are an offshoot of the Mandinga people. So we can boast or say without any shadow of a doubt that we are an African people who traded in gold across the Atlantic Ocean, and were the first to use Atlantic Ocean as a route for trade and commerce. And today, because of the enormity, because of the vast use of that ocean as a trade route, we don't even understand the amount of it. And the Europeans and those who trade across the Atlantic do not even give us credit for being the first to use it and open up that route, which we now enjoy and benefit from enormously in terms of trade between nations and across continents. That is one contribution by the Garifuna people. So without any hesitation, if and when you have an occasion to say it, don't be afraid to say that the Africans and Garinagu made a great and important contribution to the welfare and advancement of mankind. Don't be afraid to say it, because it is so. They may want to laugh at you, because when they laugh, it's simply because they did not know the beginning of it. And that may be a good chance for you to tell them that it was us who started it. I'm not saying that we are the ones using it today. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is we started it. We started it. Just like I said to you some time ago, if you see a little infant child and an old man by that child, you would want to begin, or you would want to believe that that child will never become an old man, and that that old man was never a child. But it's the real evolution of a child, growing up of a child, and the aging of a person or a child. That's one I think we need to understand. The second one that I believe we need to understand also is that agriculture, and I think I don't need to explain agriculture. Agriculture is growing your food. Africa began agriculture. And Africa gave birth to agriculture, because at first, when humankind was still very primitive, they used to just migrate from one place to the next. They would follow where the animals go, because they fed on those animals, their meat and food. And where there were food, like grains and the fruits and they were plentiful, they stayed around there and reaped the benefits of that place. The fruits, the food, the roots, and the animals that stay there, because as long as there are fruits and the food for animals, animals tend to stay around there. So our ancestors, therefore, when I say ancestors, I don't mean just Africans now. Humans would stay where there is food. And the food is not simply the things you grow, but the birds you eat, the meat you eat, etc. Where there is food, human beings or animals tend to stay. But if you are just migrating, that is, you go where the animals go, and let's say as areas are depleted, that is, there is no more food, there is no more this or there is no more the other, and the animals move away, human beings also move after the game that they were hunting, the food that they eat, etc. So as long as you are a migratory person, in other words, you're a nomad, is another word for it. Nomad means you go after where there is food, after where there is animals to feed on, animals that you can eat. You just follow them. You are a nomad or you are migratory. Now, if you can start planting or growing your food, if you can start raising your animals, you don't need to have to chase them around, because you can raise them, you tend them, or you keep them by you. And if you can grow your fruit, your food, you stay because you have your source of food and you don't have to be migrating. That is the beginning of agriculture. And Africans did that from long, long ago. So it is important, therefore, for us to understand the fact that when humankind start being able to grow its food, we start giving birth to what agriculture is. Now let's take a look at agriculture today. Agriculture is one of the greatest sources. As a matter of fact, not one of the greatest. It is one of the indispensable factors in life for human beings to survive. You have to have food. But in those days, if you are going to just follow where animals go and feed on those animals, if you are just going to go and eat the fruits, the berries, the roots, or whatever it is that you find, your life is precarious. However, when you start being able to grow them, when you start being able to grow your animals, to raise your animals, you go one step further than being just a nomad, from being just a migratory person, and from being a person who just strikes by luck and they find an area that has food. But when you can start grow your food, control irrigation, then you can start talking about agriculture. And that was very, very important in the development of mankind, and it was in Africa that started to be in. Then, to make that even better now, let's keep on going. Once you can start growing your food so that you don't have to migrate, once you can start raising your animals so that you don't have to be running after them when they're in the wild, and you start giving birth to agriculture, you become sedentary, is the word. You can stay at a place because you can grow your food, you can raise your animals, you can start developing your source of water, you can start building your house in a permanent fashion, and that is what starts giving birth to what we call residence. In other words, you live in a certain area because you have a house there, you have a source of food, you have your water, and you can take care of yourself in that one small area. You may start relatively small, maybe just a few families, maybe you and your children, and maybe some other people come from around and they stay around you. You start developing what we would call a village, a larger place. And from a village, we start building a city. And after that, we start building a country. That all began because we had agriculture to depend upon for our food, our welfare, and the other things that we have indeed established and developed today. So agriculture is another one of those great contributions by Africans to the civilization and development of mankind. All right? We have mentioned the fact of Atlantic Ocean being crossed by our ancestors, and now we have the trade route between the Americas and the old world of then, which would be Asia and Europe primarily, I mean Asia, Europe and Africa, and the African, I mean, and the American side of the Atlantic Ocean. That's one. That developed into the trade route, which we cannot do without today. But we were able to do that now because by then we had started developing agriculture. We can import and export. We can grow and do commerce and trade. And from there we go on into industries and go on into sedentary civilization, as we call it. So Africans began agriculture, and agriculture enabled humankind to be sedentary, that is to stay in one place, to develop a civilization, to develop a home, to develop a village, a city, or whatever it is. And then you can start utilizing very many other implements that you couldn't quite carry around with you whenever you move. Let's just say, for instance, if your source of food is primarily water, in other words, fish, or anything that you can get out of water, you could then use dory. But when you cross across a desert, when you go overland, you cannot carry a dory around because the dory is of no use to you in that area. So dory would not be useful for you. So you start doing something else. Agriculture becomes a thing. You no longer hunt. Let's say you hunt the, you know, deer, gibnet, or whatever. Neither do you go after the fish in the sea, just that by itself, to fish, strike, or whatever. So you have your source of food where you are because you develop agriculture and you develop the means and methods of collecting your food. That gives birth to cities, and that gives birth to civilization. So Africa being the largest, I mean, being the first nation, or not nation, sorry, being the first continent to develop, Africa started all of that, and Africa is the one that is responsible for all of that. The last one that I'm going to point out today is astronomy. Astronomy is the study of space, the stars, the moon, the this and that. Africans began that. when Africans began that, this Africans started recognizing and start understanding the place of Earth in the universe, because at one time and up to now, we still have a lot of people who believe that the Earth is the center of the universe, is the center of space. No, Earth is not the center of space. Earth is not the center of the universe. Earth is just one other object in space. It is just that. Nothing more, nothing less. But because, I mean, we know that now, because our ancestors observed space. They looked out into space. They see the moon way out there. They see stars way, way distance away. We have climate change today. We have storms such as hurricanes. And we have other kinds of storm, like dust storm. We don't have those around here because dust storm tend to occur in deserts. Belize and the rest of us around here are not a desert people. So we are not familiar with dust storms. We have I have mentioned hurricane. Every single year, from more or less June 1 to November 30th, we here in Central America, in the Caribbean, start feeling the impact of the movement of the weather, of the movement within space, the interaction between the forces of the wind, the current, the forces of cold and heat, creating this or that kind of a natural phenomenon. And every single year we have, or we expect, the hurricanes to come from the deserts of Africa. The hurricanes do not develop in Africa, but because of the transfer of heat across the Atlantic, it gives birth to weather phenomenon that creates and causes storms such as hurricanes and various others. As a matter of fact, if we had the map here by us, remember the current that the Africans followed from Africa to the Caribbean. There is that current we spoke about, that is the current that our ancestors used to move from Africa to the Caribbean, and that same current takes them back to Africa. When you notice how hurricanes come, hurricanes develop in the Atlantic Ocean. But those hurricanes invariably follow the route of that current that comes, skirts the Americas, and when it expires, when it exhausts itself, it's because it's gone back into the cold, and it dissipates in the cold and in the weathers that are upper Atlantic. All of those factors our ancestors gave birth to. In other words, the study of astronomy helps you understand that. Oceanography still helps you understand that. The study of currents help you understand that. But the point here is this, that it is astronomy that gives us the information and knowledge of the place of the Earth in the universe. We normally look up into the space and we see the stars up there. We wonder what those stars are, how far they are, how big they are. And then we know about galaxy, but it was our ancestors, the Africans, who started that study. So I think we have gone through enough of what we can go through for these series of lectures. And we have to be able to go back and repeat something that we have, because it's of great importance that all religious groups, churches, do service to the one and only God. However you name that God, whatever name you give him, there is petition. We praise, we offer, we make sacrifices, we have holy reunions, we tithe, that is, we make collections or we give offers in the church. We make collections in our congregations. But we do not consider those practices evil as we would consider witchcraft. These are the practices of civilized human beings. And those practices began with the Africans. That is what the degree is about. Giving praise to our ancestors and to the Almighty. Whether you believe it or not is not the issue. Whether any other person by you believes it or not is not the issue. What you believe and how you believe it might depend upon your experience. I'm not going to argue that, and neither am I going to stress on it. But the point is that every single one of us, sometime or the other in our life, gets to the point where we are indeed flabbergasted by things that we do not understand at one time. However, that is where technology comes in. That is where sciences come in. That is why studies come in. That is where research comes in. That is where investigation comes in. It's not very simple. Neither is it for a person who doesn't know what he is doing. These usually take a lot of analysis. It takes a lot of time to think about it, and you cannot arrive at conclusions so easily simply because you were told that that's the way it is, or that without thinking you believe that it is so. We need research. So one of the things that we have done, or I did, especially after my studies or when I was studying, that there were quite a few questions that I raised in my own head. There were so many things we were told. I remember one time when I was studying for my PhD, and I asked one professor, because they wanted to attribute all of this information to the Gurami, to the Greeks. They wanted to think the Greeks were the smartest people on earth, and every knowledge started the Greeks. And I asked him the question, how can you say that the Greeks started all of this when the Greeks learned from the Africans? Why don't you give credit to the Africans from whom the Greeks learned? He said, I have never heard of the Africans. The fact that you have never heard about it doesn't mean that they never existed. The point is that if you can take the glory of one person and give it to another, all you need to do is to speak of this glory, but to the one, about the one that you have given it to, not the one that creates it. Too often we give credit to our parents. That's fantastic and that's very good. But don't forget that they have the parents from whom they learn also. That is what culture is. That is what tradition is. So we learn from our ancestors. And the things that we know today are not necessarily the things that we find out today. Respect for ancestors is one of the characteristics of the African people. We are not rude to our ancestors or to our parents. We respect our homes. We respect our family. We respect our children. That's what civilization is, and that's the morality of the African. We learn that from Africa, not from the churches that we are learning today. No, the churches got that from the Africans, from the good, from petition, from thanksgiving, from sacrifice, from tithing, from healing. That's where we got all of this from. The 42 negative confessions are the greatest source of morality in humankind. That we don't kill one another, that we don't cheat and steal from one another, that we respect one another, that we don't do something wrong simply because we will be punished for it, but rather we create it in ourselves, we learn it at home, to be respectful of each other. That is Garifuna, that is African, and that's our contribution to the world. Run?
Very nice, Srusia, very nice. Thank you so much.
We can entertain a few questions because we have about 2 or 3 minutes.
Okay. But I wanna thank you. I wanna take the opportunity to thank you for this wonderful 8 weeks of lectures from the Garifuna history, a little bit of Garifuna spirituality, as you touch upon Dugu and the many aspects of the Garifuna spirituality. Very nice. We would like to thank the audience for staying with us week after week. And those of you who missed any of the lectures, remember that we have a GAHFU channel on YouTube where you could go and replay any of the lectures for free, 24/7, available anywhere in the world, so that you could catch up with lectures 1 through 8. Tonight's lecture will be ready by tonight, by midnight, hopefully. And so we want to invite you to please post any questions on our Facebook page, Garifuna Language and Culture Academy Online on Facebook. Also, you could send us your emails with the questions to GarifunaHeritageFoundation@yahoo.com. Also, Dr. Aranda, one question I have in my mind, and this is because we're in the month of April. What is your opinion with April 12, 1797, the arrival of Garinagu by the British into what then used to be the British islands of Roatan, which were later handed by the British to Honduras in Central America and became Honduran land? What is your opinion on that?
Okay. Rani, I have, as a matter of fact, this series of lecture that we have right now is out of a research that I made as I started. And the thing is Africa to America Park.
Yes.
That is the first research, big research about Garinagu that I'm making. And I finished the booklet and we are going to try to build a park. The second part to it, continuation of this Africa to America part, is going to be the meeting of the British and the Garinagu in Yume, when they massacred our people over there and forced them out of their homes to what is today Roatan and today in Honduras. The British did quite a lot of ugly, non-lovely things. That is evil. They massacred our parents. They took them to Baliso and they left them there to starve and everything else. The people of Honduras were never the people in Urumqi. Hondurans were in Honduras just like the rest of the Garifuna people were around the Caribbean, the Roma and the rest, Panama. We didn't need to go into all of those, and we didn't go into all of those. But the British at that time were the mighty empire, and they took advantage of, and they took the very little that our ancestors had. But that is the thing that I am going into now to do research in. What happened in Urumei? What happened in Baliso? How do the Garinagu relate to one another? There are so many people who still want to believe today that Hondurans came from Urumei. No, Hondurans did not come from Urumei. Hondurans came from Africa, just like our ancestors when they crossed the Atlantic. But they stayed in Honduras while the rest of us, I mean, our ancestors, traveled more and more. But the Hondurans also traveled a lot also. But they were stable. They stay in what today is northeast of Honduras, and they still are there. Mm-hmm. While the Garinagu that were in Urumei and in some of the other areas in the Caribbean were expelled from their homeland. That is what I'm going to do right now, and that's what I'm doing right now.
So
that maybe by next year, maybe I'll have a much, much better answer.
Okay.
And a broader answer to give you. Go ahead, please.
So real quick, the exile that happened in 1797 only came to add more to what was already there, right?
Yes, exactly. The expulsion, the exile is not the word in Aranda. I have heard people started to use the word exile. It was an expulsion. They killed them out, and those that survived, they put them into boats and shipped them out of there like cattle and pigs. That's
yes.
What the British did to us. That's no exile. That's
right.
Expulsion.
Correct.
All right. So they did that to those that were in Urumei. But they took them to Roatan, as you pointed out. And from there from Roatan, they went on to the mainland of Honduras, and from there some to Nicaragua, some to Guatemala, and some of them to Belize, and eventually to the United States. That's the story of the Garifuna diaspora. And that's what I want to go into the next time around.
Thank you so much, Surusia. It's been a pleasure. We're going to maintain contact with you, and we shall continue with these classes. On the next session, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to welcome Arufu Dahati Roy Cayetano, who will be teaching about the Garifuna language. That will be in the next 2 or 3 weeks. We'll be starting another 8 weeks, 8 lectures with Roy Cayetano right here. Same radio station, LMBRoots.com radio and WWW Radio Central America. So thank you so much, Surusia, Butigunyo, and we'll stay in touch.
Thank you very, very much, Ronnie. And thanks to the radio listeners also, to some of the questions that were interesting and even those that were challenging. Thank you very, very much. And I hope we continue the same kind of a level of discussion where we actually go deep into what our history is, who we are, where we came from, and how we got over here. Again, Ronnie, radio listeners, thank you very, very much, and goodbye.
Goodbye. Ayo. Okay.
Hola, mi seluma. Hola, mi seluma. Bayanu hanuma.
On behalf of Garifuna American Heritage Foundation United, we thank you for joining us tonight to the Clifford J. Palacio Garifuna Language and Culture Academy online. Don't forget, tune in every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time and 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time through www.lmbroots.com in the Bronx and www.radiocentroamerica.com in Los Angeles. Classes are free and for the entire family. Download the homework or the handout from our Facebook's Garifuna Language and Culture Academy page or from www.garifunaheritagefoundation.org. All radio shows are recorded or archived for your online demand. So you can find it on YouTube, GAHFU channel, anytime, 24/7. This project is made possible in part by a grant from the Alliance for California Traditional Arts, in partnership with the Walter and Elise Haas Fund the William and Flora Hewitt, and the James Irvine Foundation.